Welcome. I'm joined today by Will Felps. Will is a senior lecturer in the School of Management at the Australian School of Business and an expert in the area of groups and teams. Will, thank you very much for joining me today.
Oh, thanks for having me.
Will, can you tell us about some of the latest thinking and groundbreaking research that's happening in the area of groups and teams?
It's a tough order because there's a lot, right? There's leaders in business, thought leaders in consulting, scholars, a lot of people are sort of studying this. And I think they're studying it, you know, because teams can be, they can be great, they can be synergistic, they can be have a sense of belonging, they can provide excellent performance. They can also be terrible, right? They can be sources of frustration. Some people say teams are like a four-letter word. So the question is, how do we make sure teams really achieve their potential as opposed to are this thing that's really debilitating and draining? So my own research has thought a little bit about this subject, and especially in the context of the idea of bad apple teammates. So my dissertation subject back at the University of Washington several years ago was inspired by this notion of it just takes one bad apple to spoil the barrel. It's a saying that means, you know, you throw in one bad apple that's got fungus and the whole barrel is screwed. And the idea is that this same dynamic happens in teams. It can. If you have someone who's really negative, they can have an asymmetric, larger than life, outsized influence on the group's functioning, on his group processes, on the outcomes. So maybe a little bit of an aside, the way this topic came to me is actually from my wife. She was at a job that she didn't like very much, and she thought she was trying to look for another position. She found the place cold and hostile. She said, "I don't like the culture here." And then this guy, who was particularly kind of caustic, funny, but in a mean way, came down with a chronic illness. So he had to be gone 2 or 3 days a week. And she said when he was gone, the atmosphere changed dramatically. Suddenly, people were helpful, people were chatting. He would come back, and it would go right back to the way things were. She says, "Oh my God, it's true. It just takes one bad apple to spoil a barrel." And I said, "Ah, that's fascinating," because that wasn't something that was studied so much in the literature. And instead, the idea was that normally individuals conform to the team's wishes. In this case, the whole team was conforming to this one guy. So we identified a couple behaviors and that really seemed to spoil the barrel, a couple of negative behaviors, basically what we call withholding effort, being an interpersonal deviant, or being affectively negative. In more colloquial terms or conventional terms, we'd say someone being a jerk, being a slacker, or being a downer. So the idea is if someone's consistently and persistently displaying these behaviors, groups are likely to collapse. And then one caveat, though. Someone who is a critical thinker, who is a devil's advocate, this can be a real asset for the team. So it's important not to think that just because someone's a critical thinker or challenging the conventional wisdom, they're a bad apple. Instead, they have to do these sets of negative dysfunctional behaviors. So it's important to appropriately label these people and try to select them out, to not have them in your organization. So that's I think, some cutting-edge research, at least, that I'm involved in, about how to make sure teams don't collapse.
And Will, what are some of the practical implications for managers and leaders of some of the concepts that you talked about that are covered in this unit?
Yeah, so I was fortunate enough to read through this Managing People and Organizations document that you guys go through in the courses. And especially on teams, I found it just to be brilliant, right? So it drew a lot, especially from this book by Richard Hackman on leading teams, which is, I think, probably the best book on teams. And it's wonderful, but on the other hand, I think there's almost a danger in that document, which is that it's so concise. Every single sentence is full of pearls of wisdom. And it's very easy to sort of read that very quickly and think, okay, I've got it, and move on. Whereas it really, if you think about any one of those sentences, you come up with a lot of insights. So maybe I'll give you an example that might be a particular use. And you know, coincidentally, it's something that I study, right? So there's a sentence in there that says basically, in a real team, the individuals have distinct roles and have areas of expertise. And you say, okay, good, you know, that makes sense. But if you think about that more deeply, you think, okay, well, how do we make sure that we get that everybody has a clear role and that it's the right roles? And one of the things that the research really seems to indicate is that teams that sort of let roles emerge naturally and slowly over time perform worse than teams where it's explicit, where we say, okay, what roles are people going to have, and what am I accountable for, and what are you accountable for? And the efficiency thing there is, if I know that I'm responsible for X, then anything that has to do with X, I really become an expert about, I know about, I learn about, I pay attention to. And if something comes in having to do with Y, I can ignore it. I can totally put it out of my mind. And that's kind of efficient. That reduces some amount of deliberation. And so it reduces the deliberation and the discussion and the conflict to sort of the minimum, because you know that so-and-so is sort of the expert for this subject. So then the question becomes, okay, well, we have these different roles, we have these different areas of expertise. How do we get the right kind of pattern of expertise? How do we get the right diversity of expertise? And you know, you hear a lot in you know, this buzzword diversity. We want diversity in teams. And a lot of times when people say that, they mean, you know, they really mean sort of diversity in terms of ethnicity and diversity in terms of gender. The research that I'm aware of, it seems to indicate that on the one hand, that's really important for fairness, and that's really important for representation, but it's not a real critical driver of performance in the team. In contrast, having the right pattern, the right diversity of expertise can be a real driver of success. So for example, you know, what the research that I'm doing seems to indicate is that you want to have some balance of people who are, you know, you don't want people who know totally nothing about each other, who are experts in areas they're totally disconnected. That's sort of dysfunctional because you're talking past each other in sort of a Tower of Babel type situation. You also don't want everyone knowing the same thing, because then you have sort of missing viewpoints that aren't taken into account. And so the trick is to have some sort of optimal overlap of you know, basically people knowing somewhat about what everyone else does. And there's different ways to accomplish that, you know. But the point is that we should take it into account seriously in the design of the team. So for example, one way you could accomplish that is to have a generalist, to have one person in the team who knows a bit about everything and can serve as sort of a broker or a translator from one area to another. But that, of course, requires that person to have certain kind of social skills to be able to serve that role. But the important point is that you think about it that explicitly, as opposed to leave it implicit, which is what most teams do. And I think that's a sort of an implication, you know, from research, but that has real profound implications for practice in terms of when you're designing teams, when you're composing teams, how do you set the roles, and how do you pick the people?
Yeah. Yeah. Well, thank you very much for speaking with me today.
Oh, it was my pleasure. Thanks.